Thank you guys all.
Hi, Lacey.
Hi, Lacey.
Lacey Rose.
Lacey.
I'm going to start with one that's sort of open to all of you. Who has taught you the most about being funny on screen?
Ooh.
A lot of you have worked with, whether it's other prominent comedians, whether it's people, I mean, who?
For me, it was Saturday Night Live. You know, as a kid, you know, being a 13, 12-year-old kid in those first two seasons, I'd watch that, and then my mom would wake up in the morning and I would recreate everything. She probably wanted to kill me, but everything I learned early, I learned from Saturday Night Live.
I don't know, Jack Benny, B. Arthur.
How old are you, Jack Benny?
I loved watching Jack Benny to the point where in editing I have to edit myself literally just breaking the fourth wall because Jack Benny just, you know, kind of grabs fit and just like kind of look, and I have to stop myself from doing that. It's kind of my natural response to absurd things. So yeah. Hmm.
What about people you've actually performed with?
Oh. I would be remiss, of course, if I didn't say my partner. Because there's a lot of things I've learned from Jordan that have shown me. It's interesting. He has a great way of saying, hey, let's tackle this subject this way. Mm-hmm. But let's do what we can to make sure we play characters that aren't mean. You know what I mean? So that because I think sometimes when you're mean and a character's mean or yelling, they get didactic and you go, all right, I get the point of the sketch. Mm-hmm. Why don't you have the people living through the point as opposed to making the point with your mouth.
Lorne Michaels said to me, he says, I don't like comedy where people yell. It reminds everyone of their childhoods.
Oh.
What did he say? He said yell?
Yeah.
Yeah.
For me, I would have to say Bernie Mac. Working with him on a film called Life. And that was actually my first feature film. And to watch him come alive during his close-ups. And I was like, oh. That's what I was supposed to do when the camera was on me. Okay, can we go back? Can I get a do-over? And I was like, okay. So I learned specificity from Bernie Mac in that instance. Yeah.
I'd say I've never worked with him. I'd love to, but Tim Conway was a big.
Oh yeah.
He would do kind of the smallest thing, and he just kind of trusted these crazy circumstances he was given, so rather than push the comedy, he would just kind of sit in it and sit in the tension, and it was just funny to watch. And actually, this guy right here, Jeffrey on Arrested, mm-hmm. Because I was very new to the business when I was Arrested, and Jeffrey scared the crap out of me, and still does. but he had a confidence to his style that was incredibly, I don't know, inspiring, just because he trusted that what he brought to the table, and it had a strength to it, so it was very fun to watch him.
You feel like he was in his skin? The
yeah, I felt like I've done this too, where with comedy, it's like, you're not so in your skin, so you're pushing mm-hmm. to get the joke, you're pushing. And Jeffrey was very in his skin, Tim Conway seemed very in his skin, to where you just like to watch him because there's a comfort there.
You know, when I would watch him,
now we're just going to get help.
Well, we rehearsed this. It's going really great. Almost word for word what we did. Thank you. But I remember Mitch and I, when he was working, I would say, "What did this come from?"
A lot of
because pain. It was an entire character that was so. And I don't know if it gets funnier with the hook. I mean, you know. But you go. Who you're.
I would say definitely Amy Poehler, not only just in terms of comedic acting, but just as far as being a leader on set and just kind of, she just was just, I mean, Rob knows, just was our leader in so many ways, just ran that show with such class and I was always in awe of her and stole whatever wisdom I can. But everyone in that cast, there was just such a wide variety of different types of comedic talent, Robin included. And I feel like I just learned so much from watching all these different, just amazing performers and their different styles. And it was a treat to work on that show and learn from all those people.
Mm. Well, yes. I have to honor somebody.
Please do.
Well, my guy was, you know, Gary.
Yeah.
I remember when he did It's a Gary Shandling Show, and he broke the fourth wall, and he went, I'm going to go to the bathroom now. They're going to play the theme song, and I'll be right back. And I went, what the hell? What the hell just happened here? And I said, whatever that is, it's really funny. And he was very instrumental.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I just killed the room.
Awkward segue.
Oh, that's it for the afternoon.
That's all right. Yeah. They'll lift it.
Yeah. I'm throwing in David Alan Grier because he was like a hero of mine. Growing
me
up.
Me too.
Yeah.
It's something about Dag. I don't know. Yeah. There's something about him on that show that made me kind of go, oh, that guy's. And it was before I knew that he had gone to Yale or anything.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, that guy's. There's something funny. He had an Eddie Murphy quality where you go, that person's an actor.
He's an actor. Right. Yeah.
And so I'm noticing what I'm giggling at is a sense of surprise, but a truthful surprise. Everything was, with Dag, all the dots are connected.
Yes.
When he's performing.
It feels honest.
It feels honest.
It's very, very honest. Yeah. And it's not just leaning into the joke. It's really, it's personalizing it. And he's amazing. Yeah.
Great on your show. What's the most embarrassing thing that's happened to you as a performer during a performance, whether it's on stage, whether it's during a take of a show?
Well, listen, I think this is like we're at a poker game, and I know I've got a royal flush.
He's going to let everybody else go.
You can talk whatever shit you're going to talk.
I'll start at the mildest end. I tripped on stage. I like fell. And just like did the rest of my set from the ground, because I was like, you know what? There's no pretending this didn't happen. So I'm just gonna sit here. It's just like, so the grocery store was crazy.
Keep coming.
Yeah, yeah, just yeah. And so that's the mildest.
Mildly interesting. Okay, keep coming.
Mildly interesting.
Yeah, mild.
I've never pulled this out. I might have Jacks. I might have Cowboys.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Jordan and I did a live stand-up show up at the Shoreline Amphitheater in wherever it is, in Silicon Valley. And, you know, we're not stand-ups, per se. We're not stand-ups. We did a show for 12,000 people, and right beforehand, one of the comics who had just walked off stage is like, he had been talking to us earlier, and he's like, so you guys are kind of going to just go out there and work off of each other? And we're like, well, we're improvisers. That's kind of what we do. And, and he's like, God, that's terrifying, what you're talking about right now. But, you know, hey, you have a great set.
Mm-hmm.
I said, you have 20 minutes. 20 minutes, we'll give you a yellow light.
20 minutes?
20 minutes.
Wow.
So Jordan looks at me and he goes, we'll do some East West Bowl names, here's some funny football names. We'll get out there, make some observations, shibbity-doo, blah, blah, blah. So we go
I'm
on
already
stage.
Terrified.
Any performance that starts with shibbity-doo, blah, blah, blah. Right.
Neither of us, Jordan's done one stand-up gig in his life, right? I've done none. I'm a classically trained actor, learned the lines, right? Yeah. So we go on stage and Ari Spears had just left the stage. Khmer Rouge.
Yes.
Khmer Rouge. Just killing fields. So we walk on stage. We have our kind of our energy. There's 12,000 people.
Oh, God.
And it was the first time in my career I was like, and you guys ever think about, hey, you know, one thing, boo.
Oh.
And then it starts rolling back. And it's one of those amphitheaters where there's seats and seats and seats, and then there's a rolling hill, and there's all you just see little sparks of it. And as the night had gone on, it got decidedly bluer, it got bluer and bluer and bluer, and everybody's high. It's a concert atmosphere. By minute six, there's like 800 people over here going, come on, gosh, and just seas of rolling booze coming down the thing. And I look over at Jordan, and we always end our set when we do shows at colleges with a song that we were singing. We're 6 minutes in, and I'm trying to tell the most ribald jokes I can think of. I'm just like, y'all. And I got decidedly black. I was like, I think, you know, when you go to prison, someone's trying to rape you in prison. And nope, that didn't work. And George looks at me and goes, Keegs. I'm like, just flops wet. And he goes, want to sing a song? We're on the 7 minute mark. 9 minutes. We're on stage for nine minutes. We turn around, we walk off stage, and there's Joe Coy going, sublime.
I mean,
it was sublimely horrible.
God.
All right, I did it. I just laid. I went
that's
all in.
So
and I laid my kings on the table.
Are you still good? Okay. You still got a good hand?
I haven't even seen the river yet.
I still think I got a real flush.
Oh, man.
Wow.
Let's find out. Let's go. We'll go around.
Aziz is still nervous for me.
That's amazing story.
That's an amazing story.
All right, I attempted stand-up early in my career at the Comedy Act Theater off of Crenshaw. Everybody who's anybody has come through that room. And it was open mic night, and I went by the name Tasty Tony, the one and only. If there's another, he's a phony.
That is a long name.
Yeah.
But no, that's great.
So I'm there, and I went up the week before, and I had my support group with me, but there were so many comics ahead of me that I didn't get a chance to go up. So I said, I'll go back the next week. The next week, no one could come support me. Everybody was busy. So I was there by myself. So I'm dealing with my own insecurities. Am I going to be funny?
Oh, no.
You know, and so there were three comics that went up ahead of me, and I foolishly heckled each comic before I went up. And I was fucking hysterical as a heckler.
So your confidence was up.
Yeah, and I got my biggest laugh as a heckler, and the guy happened to call Tasty Tony, the one and only, up next. And I was like, oh, should I go up? You know, I was like, no, I've already proven that I was funny. I was like, no, that's not why you came here. You came here to tell some jokes, Anthony. So I was like, okay. So I got up and started to walk. And nobody knew who I was. You know, I was just, you know, crazy heckler in the audience. So I get up, and it's a room full of comics. And so I was persecuted as I took the walk to the stage.
Oh, man.
I get on the stage. I grab the mic. The host of the night says, you better be funny, motherfucker.
Oh no.
And so before I could get anything out, they turned my mic off.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, fuck it, I don't need a mic. And so now I'm going back. This is 10 seconds into me being on stage.
Oh, my God.
15 seconds into me being on stage, they shut my light off.
Oh, no.
So now I'm standing in darkness as everybody is throwing darts at me from the audience. And I walk off, and I go into the bathroom, and I'm shaking uncontrollably, and Guy Tori is in the bathroom, and he just happens to walk in, and he looks at me, and he was like, hey, man, and we have no idea who each other are, and he says, hey, man, now you know what not to do the next time you get on stage. Hey, but don't let that stop you.
Oh.
And I was like, okay, cool, thank you. And I didn't get on stage again for 4 years after that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and Guy had no idea who I was. I had no idea who Guy was. Guy and I are working on my first movie together, Life. Mm-hmm. And I pulled him to the side, and I tell him that story, and he says, I remember that night.
Wow.
And he was like, that was you? I was like, yeah, man. Yeah, that was me. and thank you for telling me what you told me in the bathroom. And here we are today.
Wow.
He chose to be
That's a life changing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Your hands are so
yeah.
That's amazing.
Turn the light off.
That's a life changing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was, man.
Unless anyone has any more, I want to hear.
I
know
I told this story, but I was doing repertory theater in 1967 in Detroit, Michigan.
Yeah. That's right.
How do you know that?
Because you worked with David Riegel.
David Riegel?
The first time I ever met you, Jeffrey, we talked about the fact that I...
Was it more than a week ago?
Oh, I'm sorry, it was. Duly noted. Yes,
I don't even know where my card is.
That is
anyhow. Really? Oh, we got to talk.
We will. Let's
talk now.
So at Wayne State...
We'll talk.
No, we will.
So Wayne State University, I was doing a production. And it was 1967. It was the year of the Asian flu. I had to pull my own curtain to walk on as the fourth Baron. And I was in faux chainmail. I don't know if I should go ahead with this.
Oh, you got to go now.
You got to go now.
Asian flu, and I went, wow, that seems a little, what's that? Well, I better just get rid of that little gas before I go on.
Jeffrey.
I pulled the curtain, so I kind of went like that. And completely fouled myself. Wow. Completely. No. And I'm in chainmail. And I had to walk on. Gloosh, 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 gloosh. And I talked to Beckett, and he went, how are you, Fourth Baron? And I went, and I remember him going, how are you, Fourth?
Oh!
And then I remember people in the audience going, oh, this is it. And
that's awful.
Did that.
Oh, man.
It's the most, there's no lesson to be drawn from it. There's nothing like that. It's one of the, did you see the film called The Walk?
Mm-hmm.
The Zemeckis film?
Mm-hmm.
You either get through that walk and go on with your life, or you don't. But we all have those where you go,
right.
Wow, we all have those 5 or 6 moments you go, I don't know. I don't know if I go on with a career here.
But it was terrible. And burning your costume afterwards is always interesting. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Especially hard.
All right.
How are you doing?
Yeah, how you doing? It's your turn. Lay him out there.
Here's the thing. It incorporates all elements of everything that I've heard. Backstage advice, audience member participation in not a good way, and lots of people in the theater. So it's...
Oh, wow.
I'm asked to open the Oscars.
Mm. Oh, my God. Mm-hmm. I know.
And I'm an Ohio Midwestern people pleaser. So when the Academy says, hey, will you do something? I go, yeah. You know, I'm not writing it. I'm not directing it. I'm just like, you know, from Ohio. The Academy asks you to guess. The idea, in theory, was that I would sing and dance with Snow White while Merv Griffin would then appear singing, I've Got a Lovely Bunch of Coconuts. And all of the old Hollywood establishment, Roy Rogers, Dale Evans, would be acknowledged for their... And finally, Lily Tomlin would come out of a bunch of fruit.
Okay.
Sounds great, right?
Yeah. I mean, what could go wrong?
I'm going to give that a chance.
We would all want to be a part of that,
sure,
right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So first of all, we start, and it's apparent that the old people, God bless them, can't rise or wave. So they're like just sitting at the table, so that's flat, so it begins to die. Then the girl playing Snow White, she's been rehearsing with those play cards on the seats that say Meryl Streep, Tom Hanks. It's a play card.
Yes.
Now she's got actual Meryl Streep,
right.
Tom Hanks. She's like an Anaheim, you know, Disney girl. Mm-hmm. So she freaks, and her voice goes up one whole octave.
Oh, God.
Oh, man.
From what she's meant to be. She's like this. And it's... So I finally come out and I give her that look like, whoa, hey, like that, like, hey, you, it's me and you.
Right.
We got this. She's panicked.
Oh.
And so I start doing my bump and grind. By the way, I'm singing Proud Mary. But with
Tina Turner?
Yeah.
Proud Mary?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because that's what you think of when you think of me.
Okay.
But with lyrics adjusted to the Oscars.
Yes, of course.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And look at this. Jesus' face is basically what. So this is the year that Rain Man was nominated for everything and won everything. And Barry Levinson, the director, is like, he's like the biggest thing in the world. And you know how it is when there's a big crowd and all of a sudden you fixate on one person in the crowd?
Yes,
for whatever reason, their face pops up. And I'm in the middle of singing. And I think actually I'm kind of killing it.
Right.
And I look out and Barry Levinson is doing this. And he turns to the person next to him and goes,
oh, right.
Awful.
Oh my
God. And I'm
gosh.
Like, oh, okay, that's not good. So I finish, I go off, I go, I thought it was good. Barry Levinson didn't like it. And I go into the dressing room, like your story, and there's this redheaded older woman in the green room. It's the beginning of the show, so none of the celebrities are there. And she says, young man, I had no idea you were such a good singer. And it was Lucille Ball.
Oh, wow.
And she says, come sit with me. And I sat with Lucy, and she grabbed my hand and wouldn't let it go. And we watched for 20 minutes of the Oscars, just the two of us. And then she said, darling, I have a splitting headache. Could you get me some aspirin? And so I went and got Lucy what I thought was an aspirin.
Oh, no.
I gave it to her, and she died 48 hours
later. Oh, no.
Oh, my God.
Wait, hold on.
Wait a second.
That wasn't the term I was expecting at all.
Huh? What did you give her?
What did you give her?
I think it was an aspirin.
Wait, hold on.
This turned into a crime story.
You're not holding anything.
It's like the last episode of Lost right now.
I told you.
I love it. Right? Second season of Making a Murderer right here.
This is not embarrassing. This is a warrant for your arrest.
I gave her an aspirin, but she
really did die 48 hours later.
Yeah, within a week.
Within a week, she passed away.
Oh.
Oh my gosh.
What?
Wow.
That's so...
Wow. See, that brings the proceedings to a close.
Nothing we've said.
That's what's great about hanging out with Rob. Like, Hollywood stories are all like, and I look in there, and it's Lucille Ball.
Right.
My stories are like, and then I look in there, and it's Mario Lopez.
That's great.
You? It's me and DMX.
All right, do you guys wish you knew about some success in Hollywood when you started out in the business? And if there is anything you would do differently, knowing what it is you
I was raised in a house where the napkins were, don't celebrate, they'll take it away from you. So, and really, that was on, I mean, it was like on the arch over the door.
Uh-huh.
Any sort of success
explains
was always
so much.
Don't celebrate, don't take it away from you.
That was my dad's motto, you know? Yeah. And so I've always been very, very, I mean, I'm sure it's tricky. It's tricky.
I feel, you know, Rob's from Ohio, I'm from Michigan. We both have this Midwestern people pleaser ethos, right? And I think, I wish I had known, the problem is you don't have a crystal ball, right? Mm-hmm. So you wish you knew at the beginning. Everyone at the beginning says, oh, you gotta make hay while the sun is shining. You gotta make hay. And then you say yes to every single thing.
What he said.
You say yes to every single thing. And the problem is there's no one, I did a film recently, Anna Kendrick said, no one comes to your door on a particular day and goes, hey, hi, we're the famous people. Here's the manual.
Yep.
So you have to apprentice yourself to someone because you don't know when to say no. I'm still learning now when to say no, and there's this amorphous moment.
Also, that's where it came from when you told me no?
Oh,
is that I'm just curious. Because you do know how to say no.
Yes, Anthony.
Oh, wow.
Yes, you do.
Wow.
This got
I have learned
just,
to say
it. We just
it.
Got rid of for like five.
I was shaking. I'm just saying. He knows how to say no.
Wow.
He
does.
He does. But why then? Why did he learn that?
Because it's being able to, and that everybody says this, right? It's like following your heart, and you hear people say that, and I go, oh, that's more difficult than I thought it was going to be. So the thing is, I love him. I love his work. I love Kenya. I love Tracy. The kids are amazing. And then I go, my agents go, no, we're not. Don't point at us, Keegan. You said you wanted to do features. You said you wanted to get into that space. We're doing what you asked. But Anthony's going to be mad. you know what I mean? Uh-huh. No, but this is what you said you wanted to. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, be careful what you wish for.
Yeah.
But the weird thing is I wish I knew a little earlier that, okay, my heart is really in this thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you don't know.
You don't know what these are. Mm-hmm. Don't worry about them. Go for that one.
Mm-hmm.
Go
Can
for
I say
that
a quick one,
one
and then I'll be quiet. I wish someone told me at the beginning, because I thought, like Cinderella, there was a ball.
Mm-hmm.
There is no ball.
There's no ball.
No.
I mean, there are really great parties.
Yeah.
And they're really, and there's like, you get to go,
no glass slippers.
I've
a lot of glass
wanted
tables
to meet you.
Yes, but no glass slippers.
Or I love you or, but there, I wish I knew that because you're the ball. But you can't tell a young actor that. Anyway, I'll shut up. You guys.
Well, to add to that, I would say I would. There's something about, I think, in this business or anywhere. It's like you'll have value when.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Your value stays the exact same way before, however you define success, before you have success, until and then after you have success.
Mm.
Your value is the exact same. And we're not taught that in this business. Just value as, outside of everything, value as Tony Hale has stayed the exact same.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not something I think you hear.
No.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah.
They also, somebody said recently, I was reading an article recently, someone said, it's interesting, in our culture, people teach you when you're younger. Our parents are all very concerned about us being hurt or irreparably scathed in some way by life. So they teach us how to manage and deal with failure. But no one teaches you how to manage and deal with success.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of that thing is that, you know, remember everybody told you if you went to school, make sure to have a minor. Or maybe do the acting major in that.
Really
they're helping you there. Mm-hmm. But the hard thing is that no one, your mother loves you more than anyone in the world, but she didn't think this was going to happen for you either.
And then it happens.
Yeah. I'll just add this, that fame is the only drug for which there is no 12-step program.
Yeah, mm-hmm. No, that's a good point.
I wish I had that internal skill. Like you ever see The Devil's Advocate, where you just see the demon.
Yeah, of course, with Keanu Reeves. Yes, I've seen
it. You know how like you see the demon in like a not saying people, but there's a lot of like disingenuous, you know, rhetoric that gets said, and like you could tell when agents are agenting you, you could tell
right.
when people are doing those things, and I just wish you could kind of see, like, oh wait, that's a
you
mask.
Put up a lens,
yeah,
go,
put up a lens,
he's
like,
a
oh,
demon.
Okay,
he's
yeah,
a
yeah.
demon.
Yeah, there's a demon in there. Yeah, run, yeah. you know, get out of there.
I was just gonna say, I think the thing I've learned and still have to keep reminding myself of, even now, is that you kind of have to make your own way. And for me, I felt like writing my own stuff, especially with Master of None, like no one would have given me a show like that. No one would have believed I could have done that. No one would have given, it would have definitely have gone to some white guy. You know, I mean, I just don't think they would have given it to me. And I think it's easy sometimes to kind of just sit around and wait for an opportunity and wait for someone to open a door. But I think if you look at people that have really done interesting stuff, they're people that make their own doors all the time, and then hopefully something opens. And I have to always remind myself of that, to always just make your own way and write your own stuff.
Everyone has the best intentions, but no one knows what the fuck they're talking about.
It's true.
One knows. I mean, because you can't, because it's such a personal thing, and it's such a different path for everybody. And everyone's like, you gotta do this. I've heard a million times the things you gotta do.
Right.
And it's touching on what everyone said. But you don't have to do anything, especially if it's not true. I think people, they notice that. They know when you're doing something outside of yourself. So it's like, no one really knows right. what, they can't tell you how to do anything.
Right.
Sure.
You know, growing up, you know, coming from nothing, you know, growing up in Compton in the inner city here in L.A., you know, just piggybacking on what you said about, you know, making hay while the sun shines. Mm-hmm. No one ever teaches you about balance.
Right.
You know, and I learned the hard way being a husband and a father, missing out on some of those key moments in my children's mm-hmm. life and just in my family's life, because I was so focused on getting this so we could have a better.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
But then if I get this,
then exactly.
we'll get even
better.
So it never stops.
Yeah.
It never
saying,
ends.
Right? It just never ends. Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
So Anthony, your show this season, and obviously you are very involved also as a producer on it, has tackled some really powerful subjects, whether it's gun control, whether it's the Edward. I mean, I think the most powerful, arguably, was the episode that tackled police brutality. Mm-hmm. And what was interesting about that was you did it through this, how do you have those conversations with your children? And
right.
I'm curious how the sort of the tone on set and what were the conversations when the cameras were off with both the adult actors, but also there are kids on that show, and on some level, those conversations have to be had in that process.
You know, what's interesting, Kenya, who's my partner in this and who created our show, actually wrote that episode based on what was going on in Ferguson. Mm-hmm. He has five children, and he was watching the news with his younger sons, who were maybe 5 and 7 at the time, or maybe a little bit younger. And one of his sons turned to him and said, "Dad, why is everybody so angry?" And, you know, he was forced into that conversation with his child. And before that, how do you have that conversation with your child? And that's what forced him to write this episode. And looking at the young actors who play Jack and Diane on our show, those were the same questions that they had, mm-hmm. you know, because they were so innocent and so pure, and they're only 10. 10 years old, and it was like, well, why is this happening?
Mm.
You know, what's going on why everybody's so upset about this? And we had to have real conversations with these young actors about what's going on in the world and why it is important for us to tackle these issues and talk about them. But how do you start that conversation with a 9 and a 10-year-old or a 5 and a 7-year-old? You know, we pride ourselves on dealing with divisive topics on our show that bring people to a table not unlike this who have differences of opinions and, you know, create that dialogue. And hopefully when we leave this table, we have a better understanding of who sat across from us.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, is this the guy that got shot in front of the college at the traffic stop?
No. No, that was Charleston.
Charleston was the
unarmed guy who got shot in the back. Cincy was the traffic stop.
Oh. Well, wait, then what was New York?
Oh, New York was the unarmed guy who was selling cigarettes. They got choked.
Cigarettes!
Yeah, this is the unarmed guy who was selling DVDs. They got tased 37 times.
Wow, is he okay?
He got tased 37 times. So, you know, he's not great.
I mean, your children are older now. Are these conversations that you had with them, and how did they differ from how your character
You know, my personal children are 16 and 20.
Right.
So these are conversations that we've had in the past. But you know, you have to tackle these things head on. Mm-hmm. You know, so your children know what they're dealing with in this society and in this world. You know, I've created, and I'm pretty sure we've all created a vacuum in which our children live in, and because we want to protect them. And you know, but that is not the real world. My daughter is a sophomore in college now, dealing with racism on her own for the very first time in her young adult life. And I've tried to insulate her and protect her as much as I could up until this point. But now she's a young woman, and she has to go out in the world and fend for herself.
Yep.
And she's dealing with that on her own, and I think she's dealing with it masterfully.
Mm-hmm.
But those are the realities in which we live.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
So you just mentioned Ferguson. Key and Peele was obviously... That show, your show was still very much on as those conversations were very much in the sort of zeitgeist, if you will. How much sort of pressure did you feel, or responsibility did you feel to tackle and include skits about race?
Quite a bit, actually, because I think people, you check your Twitter feed and everyone's like, why isn't Luther talking about this? You know, why isn't Luther talking about that? And I have to give quite a lot of credit to my partner, who he's the base of the light bulb, and I'm the filament. And so I need him to go, let's just keep writing our reality and writing what, and keep leaning into what we find comedically, structure-wise, is going to work for us. Then if we have, our reality is going to reflect off of other people, and they'll think about it based on what we're just doing in regard to our reality. So if you think of a sketch like White Person Hoodie, which is really great, because what Jordan did is he made a proactive sketch that was comedic. Like I was saying, it's fighting that didactic nature of satire sometimes. So if I live in this world, what would I do to make my life easier? Was the question he asked himself to write that sketch. And I think that became a mantra for us, which is, what can we do that's, because in this case, if we're doing something proactive, it's going to be healing. Because a person can say, well, I don't want to make a white person hoodie, but I can see where a person's thinking forward. Mm-hmm. Like, how do I move through this as our nation lives in these growing pains that we're in right now? And so there was quite a lot of pressure, but I feel like with our staff and with each other, we would treat ourselves gently and say, as long as we're coming forth with some kind of joy and we're living our lives, let's not try to reach out too far. Right. As long as we're living our lives, it will reflect. Because very often, if you're a person of color, the fact that you have melanin in your skin makes the sketch exist on more than two or three levels.
And if those don't work, you know I'm working up that plan B, brother.
You have a gun?
Oh yeah, 3D printer, baby. 100% polyurethane. They can't detect these mammograms.
They have a weapon!
Who got a weapon?
He's got a weapon!
Where you at, Terry?
I found him! Relax! We're taking control of this place!
It's so interesting that people talk about, but you have to tackle Ferguson, you have to do this stuff. We were never in a place to make topical stuff because the show took so long to make.
Mm-hmm.
And I always thought some of the most revolutionary things we did, it's like, we want to do a sketch about Victor Hugo and Les Miserables. So we're going to do that sketch. We just happen to be people of color.
Uh-huh.
We're going to put on our powdered wigs and our cravats and do our sketch.
Mm-hmm.
And that should just be okay.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? Let's just do that sketch. Uh-huh. You know what I mean? Or these two guys, why do we have to justify why we have melanin?
Right.
and we're not there yet. My hope, and I've said this a bunch of times, my hope down the line, 100 years from now or 200 years now, if you're looking at an archive, I would love someone to watch a Key and Peele sketch and go, I don't get this at all. I'd love them to hate how stale our show is. This show is stale and doesn't really have a point. I don't get this show.
Right.
That's my prayer for Earth.
I love
is that
it.
Our show has no meaning in 200 years.
Sure, yeah. Sure. Yeah. Now, Jerrod, obviously, you've talked about sort of wanting to be that voice of challenge, I think it was a direct quote. And you kicked off the current season of your show tackling the sort of tarnished legacy of Bill Cosby, which was a bold move. And I'm curious, A, why you felt it was important to do, and B, how it was received once you did, particularly in the Black community where he had opened so many doors.
The Bill Cosby episode was the same as when we did the protest episode, when we did the kale episode. We did all these things that were based on conversations and real life things that were happening. I have an obligation as a comedian, as someone who exists in the world, to just reflect those conversations. And so I just do it as honest as possible. I think what's important, what's interesting, and speaking to what you were saying, is this is one of the first times in American history where Black people are able to be genuinely just human beings. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, we're able to really exist in America, and our conversations can not necessarily fit into a box or be inhibited in any way. Mm-hmm. We can argue, and we don't necessarily take one side of an argument, and it's balanced. And the intention of my show is to reflect that. So when we did the Bill Cosby episode, it's like any other episode where it's like, well, what's the honest truth? What are the honest feelings around this topic? And we just put that out there.
Just face it, talent is more important than morals.
What, more important? According to who?
According to you, the same woman who, despite many accusations, continues to listen to Michael Jackson.
Well, if she's listening to Michael Jackson, I can go see Bill Cosby.
Did anyone, Black or white, tell you not to do it?
Yeah, sure. A lot, mostly lawyers. yeah, of course. It was the most legal note session that I've encountered. Yeah. You know, it's mostly lawyers, but it was, not doing it wasn't an option. Mm-hmm. We were just going to do it. Right. Like, there was no other option. We were just going to do it. Yeah.
Sure. I want to also talk about, you mentioned getting the opportunity with Master of None, or creating the opportunity for yourself. And with both of you, I want to talk about the sort of the responsibility of representation. And you guys are both playing lead characters who aren't particularly well represented on television. And I'm curious what kind of responsibility that comes with as actors, as creators in your case.
You know what's interesting is, when we were doing the show, I never really thought about this stuff. And then when it came out, and what was interesting about the show coming out on Netflix is, like, everyone watched every episode in one weekend. And this reaction was like, oh my God, I've never seen, like, Indian people or Asian people or, you know, the Denise character, an African-American lesbian woman. I've never seen these people depicted in this way, like, just like normal people, and not like, I don't know. I think a lot of times, if you see an Indian guy or an Asian guy, they're fitting into certain tropes, and you know, you never see, like, an Asian guy who's really, who's capable with women or anything like that. Mm. And I just realized, you know, me and Alan, the guy who I created the show with, were really just writing to our reality and what was honest to us, like right. you guys yeah. were saying. And I think the fact that we came from our backgrounds, our reality is different. And a lot of times, I heard this thing that Lee Daniels said one time, and I think it was probably one of these kind of things, where he said something about white writers writing for Black performers and how it was insulting. And I was like, wow, I've never really thought about that. And a lot of times when people write for Indian actors or Asian actors as well, or anybody, someone different, it is insulting because they have a certain view of, oh, this is how that person can help our plot. You know, I mean, the most basic thing, mm-hmm. being like, oh, this Indian guy, let's put him in the cab or in the mart. Like, let's not make him the guy who's this woman's love interest or something like that. Let's get the white guy for that, of course. You know.
What's wrong with Star Trek 2?
They got a white guy to play an Indian guy?
With the robot movie? With Johnny Five?
Wait, you don't know this?
Wait, which Indian guy are you talking about?
Dude. That guy's a white guy.
The robot or the Indian?
The Indian guy is a white guy. That's Fisher Stevens. They use brown face makeup.
Wait, what?
Yeah, they got a real robot and a fake Indian. You know, with our show, it worked out in this great way where we were just being true to ourselves and writing things that were just very true to us. As Jerrod was saying, like, I think, you know, we're friends. We both come from the stand-up world. And I think, you know, both of us have toured together and I think have a similar view on stand-up and writing. Of like, we write what we're passionate about and what's in our heads and what we're thinking about. And I think when you do that in an honest way, I really believe the idea that the most personal things end up being the most universal. And I think, you know, in our show, when we did the episode about our parents, and that was so personal, I didn't think it would resonate the way it did, but that I had people from many different countries, you know, Jamaica, places in South America, come up to me and be like, oh, that really hit me. And it was really cool. So,
sure.
You know, I don't know how to think about that responsibility. I just can only just
be honest story. With myself and tell what stories are interesting to me.
The more personal you get, the more universal everything becomes.
Yeah, it feels like it should work the other way around.
Yeah, you would think so.
That's how it works.
Yeah, the more personal, because, I mean, you know, as cliche as it sounds, it's like, oh, we do all have the same experiences.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it may not be in the same context, but it's all the same experience.
That's not even just political stuff. Like, there is relationship stuff we did where I took very, very specific things and people were like, why did you do that?
Shouldn't have put that in there. That's way too real.
I got into a fight with my girlfriend because of that scene.
Yeah, yeah. Everyone thinks the specific thing that they do is like really unique. And like the advice, take fountain. Right?
Take
it's just
fountain,
like, well, everybody's taking fountain. Right. Right. You know, we're just so LA specific. But,
Jeffrey, what about you? I mean, is there the responsibility that comes with that? And how does that sort of manifest itself in you and in your process?
I love what you said about the obligation of comedy. I've never heard that phrase, and it's so perfect because there is an obligation in comedy. Mm-hmm. And I think that is the revolution. You mentioned Lucille Ball, and I went, isn't it interesting how this comedy wheel has changed? Yeah. Because we used to watch, you know, that, and with the laughter, and like, God, and, you know, beat it, you know, like, and now we're talking, having this conversation, and there is a revolution here. And it's quite beautiful. And I love that word, obligation. I mean, Jill Soloway changed my life. I mean, she just handed me this role of Maura Pfefferman, and I'm a cisgender male actor essaying this role. And so it's a great privilege and a huge responsibility that even in the third season just keeps tapping at me every day. And then my motto is do it right. And it weighs on me. I have a responsibility. And then it goes on. It just goes on. I'm having these conversations on the set. I mean, in terms of Maura talking and then I'm having these conversations in life. Mm-hmm. And people are coming up to me. And I remember a gentleman coming up to me on the plane and he was all Zenyed. I'll get the suit now. he was all Zenyed and cufflinked and coiffed and shooed and everything like that. And he went like that to me. And I went, oh, so here it comes. Here it comes. And he came up to me and he went like that. And he put his hand in mine and he said, you, thank you for introducing me to a subject I had no knowledge of. And I went, well, there's the revolution. Yeah. And for some reason, that conversation tells on me because I went, well, that's, and I've had the other conversation where I say, you can't say that word. Mm-hmm. You can't talk like that. You can't talk on the street.
Sure.
And, you go, you can't. And so my life has changed.
Do you plan on getting breasts?
Two, please.
Do you plan on undergoing gender reassignment surgery?
Yeah, we're gonna have to get back to you on that one.
Mrs. Pfefferman, do yourself a favor and get to know your body.
What I think is interesting is that for me, and I've always thought this, that laughter wasn't merely laughter, but it was a teaching instrument. I actually think back in the Greek festival, you know, they say, well, there was the tragedy and then there was, you know, then they did the comedy. I actually think if we go back, it was the comedy.
Yes.
And it was that Oedipus sleeps with his mother. Who cares? Later. Move on. You know, I mean, who hasn't slept with? No, anyhow. I think what's so interesting about this is that it is now a teaching instrument. Mm-hmm. And in the laughter and beyond the laughter, you can change.
Yep. Yep.
And so I love, again, back to you, the obligation, because that's a huge mantle.
Sure.
And what a time to be a performer now. The revolution, as a young actor, I mean, I would call home and my mother say, I'd say, I'm on MASH. And she would say, what number? And I'd say, two. And she would say, oh, we get two. And now it's more than two, five, and seven.
Yeah.
It's like, hello.
215.
And the revolution is here. And God, you know, this is the ball we're talking about. This is the ball.
This is it.
Yeah.
Yes. Rob, I mean, to Aziz's point about sort of opportunities not perhaps being open, you've been vocal about sort of earlier in your career, doors not opening because you were the sort of quote unquote sort of pretty boy. The ingenue, and that the parts that you perhaps wanted.
I'm the ingenue.
The parts that you wanted to play, perhaps you weren't sort of taken.
Oh yeah, no, considered. You can't play cops.
Mm-hmm.
You can't play. Oh yeah, what are they? The list is actually kind of long.
Rob, can we switch problems?
They didn't want me to play. They didn't want me to play cops or detective, whatever it is.
They just kept wanting you to play leading men, love interest. No,
it's boring. That gets boring.
Yeah. Well, you know what's interesting is whenever we did an episode of our show called Old People, and the whole episode, I'm pretty much hanging out with this woman who's my girlfriend in the show's grandmother, mm-hmm. and I was talking to this actress, and. She was telling me, like, she's like, this is so great. I'm so excited to do this part because normally when I get stuff, it's old people parts. And I was like, what is that? She's like, oh, you know, I'm like falling down. I'm a rapping granny.
I'm a rapping granny.
Everyone has their
Everybody
thing.
Has, yeah.
Everyone has, no matter who you are.
You get pigeonholed somehow.
Yes, someone's like, well, I'm used to seeing, you know, whether it's Rob, I'm used to seeing him do these kind of things. If you're someone older, I'm used to seeing this. If you're a minority, okay, this. So I feel like everyone does have those things. I don't mean to kid your saying.
When in your career did that change? And is the grinder a role that you previously wouldn't have been able to have?
I mean, I think because, I mean, I can't, there's less great stand-ups here. And a lot of people who are way more well-versed in comedy than I am and who have been way more well-versed longer than I am. I come to it as initially from being a dramatic actor.
Yep.
So I have more of a focus because I'm transitioning to that, to being funny. Mm-hmm. Like on the grinder, we gotta be funny. Mm-hmm. That's our lane.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, laugh out loud, funny. And so, and that's, you know, was new for me. It started probably when I started teaming up with Mike Myers and Farley and Spade and Lorne and all those things is probably where it started to happen for me. And then I think even on the West Wing, my character kind of delivered some of the more effervescent, lighter moments. But that I'm able to do both because all my heroes really did. I mean, people forget Tom Hanks is hilarious in sitcoms.
Oh, yeah.
But that's what makes you good in comedies is that, and same thing we're saying about David Alan Grier earlier, is people, it is dramatic. It's tension that needs to be broken, and you have to be able to create that tension in order to you know, let the air out. And so coming from a dramatic background is so beneficial to comedy. I'm always like, leave your fucking funny face at home. Give me real tension. Give me something honest as opposed to just this, you know, crazy guy.
Leave your funny face at home. I'm going to use that.
Yeah, please. Leave it at home. I don't want you to just... Oh, I'm so crazy. Like, no one wants to hang out with that person.
Right.
No one wants to see that person.
Because you don't know, because you actually don't know that person.
Yeah.
In a vacuum or in context of any part of life, you don't know that person.
Yes.
That person's already been locked up in Bellevue.
Yes.
You don't know that person because you would just walk away from the situation.
Mm-hmm. Steve Carell's a quote. He said, an actor in a comedy shouldn't be aware that they're in a comedy.
Mm. Correct. Right.
And that's so honest. Yeah. Why are you smiling at me?
Right.
This should be the most serious thing that's happening in your life right now. And the situation can be funny, and it could be funny because you said like a very serious, perhaps absurd thing in that moment, but it has to be real.
We do, on the grinder opens every episode with an episode of the fake show, The Grinder.
Mm-hmm.
And there are times, and I'm telling you, it looks like it's Scandal.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like we're doing Grey's Anatomy, man.
Oh, sure. Right,
for
right.
Sure.
Yeah.
Right.
And I'm definitely doing Caruso in CSI, man, but for realsies.
Yeah.
And you know, every once in a while, the network will be like, will people know that it's funny? I'm like, they'll know.
They got it.
They'll know.
Right. Right.
But that's the thing is you gotta play, to your point, you gotta play for keeps.
So you can either be the bigger person and just tell us who it is, or I will be forced to open that envelope.
All right. You know what? I'll do it. Grinder Rest?
Yeah, you see, you were supposed to say the name, right? first and then open the envelope, read grand arrest, and then be burned by that.
Yeah, that would have been better.
Why did you destroy this office? Who are you working with?
If I have to deal with one more note of just like, can we make sure the girl smiles?
You what?
Know,
mm-hmm.
Make sure she smiles so she knows that knows you're playing with her. It's like, yeah, well, first of all, I'm not playing. I'm saying a serious thing, and it's like
totally.
Yeah, and everyone's attempt to make everyone likable, they make people look fucking stupid. Mm-hmm. Like you look dumb. Like let's make them likable. It's like, well, she wouldn't smile in that moment.
It's creepy.
Why would she smile in that moment? I just said a very real kind of messed up thing. She shouldn't smile. That makes her look, mm-hmm. you know. And so we try and ignore all of those things. Everyone's terrified.
I've been very lucky with it. I was thinking about Gary and HBO, mm-hmm. and I was thinking, mm-hmm. you know, Mitch Hurwitz, and then with genius Jill Soloway. We've been benighted that the people just go. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Go,
well, Mitch
go.
Just didn't listen to them during your Fox stint, I think, with arrested the first time around.
You got to ignore what's not true.
Oh, yeah. I will say one. Well, I just had to throw this in, though. When I got the script of The Grinder, I couldn't believe that Fox was going to make it on a network, because we've all pitched a lot of things, and anywhere else they would have said, we love it, this is amazing, this is a role you were born to play, does he have to be an actor?
Mm.
Without a doubt.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Any other network without a doubt would have said that.
Mm-hmm.
Could he be like an accountant? Because that's the point, is he's an actor.
Yeah.
That
little rock that weighs 5,000 million pounds is moving,
mm-hmm.
because of you guys. Because of you guys.
I was just going to say, guys my age are moving on, and and the kinder are coming up, as my Yiddish for kids. So they're coming up and they're throwing down.
Yeah,
you know they're going.
And also the other version of it is failing. You know, it's failing.
It's the data. The thing is, absolutely. Because we have channel 215 and 408 and 672, because we have that many channels, you cannot eventually, because what they do very much is they rely in a science that doesn't really exist, mm-hmm. and metrics.
Yep. Yeah.
So if we can prove through the data, the old way isn't working.
Yes.
Guys, we're using your technique. It's the data. It doesn't work. So
there is a guy in New York who's doing Hamlet as Gary Busey.
Amazing.
Yep. I'm not kidding. I read a review. He's doing it as Gary Busey.
I love it.
What's going on?
That's the world
we're in. Great.
All right, Tony, so Julia recently talked about how how Veep has become, given the sort of the current political climate and the sort of circus, if you will, that's going on, that Veep went from, at the beginning, a political satire to now on some level a somber documentary.
Yeah, sure.
Yes. And I'm curious, as a performer, looking around.
I'm just trying to.
It's a somber documentary.
Yeah, I mean, how do you compete with the reality when the reality is as crazy as.
This is our relationship for the past 10 years. I think, well, so how do you just kind of deal with the fact of what's going on in the news?
Yeah, do you guys feel pressure to now amp it up? I mean, all of a sudden, what you guys are doing are.
Yeah,
not
sure.
Not that crazy anymore.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's the thing. Like, if they had written what's happening in the news today, the people would come in and be like, "Nah, it's not real enough." So I guess I get joy from I can just speak to the joy that I get from the show, and the joy that I get from the show is, I think, even though I want Trump completely gone from everything, there's something about his crazy that I think is actually everywhere, but people just don't talk about it. You know, it's like his crazy's out there, but everybody's a work in progress. Everybody's got some crazy.
Where are you from?
Birmingham, Alabama.
Underrated city.
you're telling me. You're telling me. They call it the Pittsburgh of the South.
You come from a big family, do you?
I do come from a big family. I do. It's actually just me. I'm an only child.
Our show takes you behind the scenes and shows the crazy. Like, you know, there's a lot of these politicians, like, they put perfect, you know, they say perfect sound bites, they do what they do. But, you know, behind the scenes, they're, like, getting insecure, they're freaking out, they're trying to position themselves to get forward, they're cussing out their assistant, whatever, you know? And it's, I love that we just kind of show the crazy that I think is there,
mm-hmm.
you know? So I think Trump is completely batshit, but I'm kind of like, yeah, well, that, there's some crazy there, and I think there's some crazy other places, and we just happen to highlight that a lot of times.
Yeah, absolutely. What do you guys, when people sort of assume you guys are funny, and presumably it happens when people come up to you and want you to be funny, and perhaps even say precisely that, what do you do in those circumstances? Does that happen? I mean, has that happened?
Sometimes, yeah. I think in the past it has. I mean, I'm not a stand-up, so I don't have that tremendous skill that I'm so inspired. I think it's amazing. So I think a lot of my comedy comes from just like being bullied. You know, it's like, I was an anxious kid. You know, I've learned how to use my anxiety.
Are people like, let me be mean to you?
So it's like, to be funny, it's just, I enjoy kind of try to play something real in a crazy circumstance, kind of living that tension. But I'm not a jokester. I mean, my daughter just bought a book of jokes, and like, I just enjoy her jokes. So if people want to be funny, I'm like, she's got some good ones. You know? So I don't know. It's not really my. I'm not great at that. Yeah.
What I mean, you guys are both in.
I always say, you tell me what you need. I'll give you the price points. Yeah. And then we'll go from because let's have a conversation. Be funny, and I'll go. Give me money. Yes. Because you see how right now I didn't tell you architect a house for me.
Right. Yeah.
I would, because those are that's my vocation. It's my vocation. So vocation's not a good word because you're saying, well, if it's because that involves passion, right? So if it is my vocation, well, wouldn't you want to be funny all the time? But I think that there is it's like a mission to separate it, which is that's my craft. Mm-hmm. I worked very hard to do that. And so that's how I generate commerce is by doing that. So in this moment, we can have a pleasant time and maybe something that you weren't expecting that's humorous or light comes from our conversation. But to be funny in a vacuum, I say that give me money thing because I'm the same way. Like I'd rather. What you've watched me do has made you laugh in a context. Mm-hmm. But you can't always expect a person to go, yeah, but
this is why he said no.
You're always fun. That's what I said.
I get it.
Yeah.
But also, this is when
I started learning to say
I'm glad he did say it.
You want to take a moment, though. You have to kind of like exist in what funny people need a moment to think. And a lot of times, like, I'm really quiet. And it's like you'd probably be surprised by the amount of chefs that eat McDonald's when they go home. Mm-hmm. You know, it's right, like, right, I've kind of been in the kitchen all day. You know, like,
There's also such a crafting to it. I mean, there's so much work that goes behind the scenes to make these shows and the writing and stuff. And it's, I mean, I don't think people see that kind of matrix that's involved to try to get it there.
The other thing people always say, particularly, I'm sure you probably got it on Parks and Rec because it's just the style of it and the types of actors that we had and for sure Arrested Development. Well, all of these shows that we're talking about is, so do you make up a lot of it? Is a lot of it ad-lib?
That's true.
But don't you get that
all the time?
Which, to me, I always take as a compliment because it means we're making it look like we're making it up, which is the ultimate, right? Yeah. And usually what it is we have amazing writers.
Yep. Absolutely.
And we have that architecture.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And our job is to make it look real. Now, that said, I'm going into my fourth decade doing this.
So awesome.
And it's,
it really
it's crazy. It's like, I never thought I would be here this long, and I'm so grateful for it. But I've seen with guys like Aziz, the level of ad-libbing and being, you know, facile and playing within the structure of shooting, at least from my experience, didn't really exist like it does today.
Yeah.
Like today, we're talking about young actors. I mean, my young son, John Owen, is doing 5 episodes of The Grinder, and he's literally learning. And I'm saying, you know, don't take an acting class. That's the fucking last thing you should be taking. Take an improv class. Go to UCB and learn how to play and learn how to be present and learn how to riff, because that's what people are doing more and more and more. And that wasn't the case when I was coming up at all.
No. What were the most challenging periods? I mean, Anthony, was there a point where you thought maybe this isn't right for me, I'm going to try something else?
No. You know, call me foolish or naivete, but this is all I've ever prepared myself to do. How old are you?
Nine.
Eight. Wow. Was there a challenge? I mean, what was the sort of the you most know, challenging my, period?
My most challenging thing was getting a job, getting other people to believe in me the way that I believed in myself.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, this is, yeah, I've never. I take that back. I wanted to be a lawyer and eventually become a judge.
Mm.
I wanted to, even though I grew up in L.A., I wanted to play football for the Dallas Cowboys because they were America's team growing up. And I wanted to be an actor. And at the age of 9, I realized that if I became an actor, I could be all three of those things and whatever else I wanted to become in life.
Mm-hmm.
And since the age of 9, consciously and subconsciously, this is what I've been preparing myself for, not only where I am right now, but where I see myself 20, 30 years from now. I never took no personally.
Yeah.
Mm. And I just, you know, persevered through all of that. So it was just a matter of getting others to believe and get on board into what I believed in myself.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that, so that was the hard part. You know, but that was part of that's part of the journey.
Yeah.
You know, it's part of my journey.
I was 8 and I lived across the street from a theater, and I just thought, whatever they're doing, my goodness.
Sign
just,
me up.
And, you know, ladies and gentlemen, places, please. I mean, what do you need, you know?
Yeah.
And curtain calls and all like that.
We're such nerds.
But Brian Grazer's, I was asking him about when, is it Splash when they were, that was their, and I said, and I was talking about how do you guys get started? And he did a wonderful thing.
Night Shift.
Was it Night Shift?
Night Shift.
But Splash came, it was all around, Night Shift and then Splash.
Night Shift's the first movie. Mm-hmm.
And he just said, you know, something like, well, this is the sound of a career. No, 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 yes, no, 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 no. And I've always had trouble with, I still, you know, I take no's personally. Cancellations. You know, people, you're going to work, you're doing anything like that. But it's not about that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not even about no. It's about not only is my craft in here, but it's the girl I made out with at Lake Merced in San Francisco. It's all in this.
Yep.
There's either, you're either all in or you're not.
Right.
And it's personal when you act.
Sure. Yeah.
And then when you have somebody go, well,
it's personal if you're good at it.
Well,
you know, I think it's even personal.
You're great at it, so it's like, that's why, it reflects. It's like,
the show is personal,
right.
The business is not.
And being fired, you know, I mean, I was fired, well, I won't even mention, I was fired on the air.
Sorry.
I was fired by a guy who just said, we're going another way, and I didn't know what he was saying. I went, oh, well, let's go. What way are we going? No, we're going another way. And I said, you know, because I have some notes about
it. I have choices that go the other way. Yeah.
Are we going, like, costume another way or character? And he went, no, we're going another way, and it's without you.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Oh, man. It.
All right, so we're going to end on some lighter questions. When you guys first made it, the first time you got that real paycheck and felt like, okay, this is happening for me, what was the big splurge? What was the,
You didn't splurge because you were worried it wasn't going to come up next.
What was the thing you spent that,
you buy?
That paycheck? Yeah, what'd you buy?
I was so, I was like, store it. You don't know how long it's going to last.
Like under your mattress, store it? What are you talking about here?
Well, I mean, because it's so gig to gig. So my first big gig, I was just kind of like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah,
we don't know if it's going to come again.
Yeah. No, the moment I got the check, I went to the bank and cashed it. I didn't deposit. I cashed it and put the money in the shoebox. Nike shoebox in the top of my closet.
Yeah, because
you never know.
I think that I was married at the time, and I think what happened is I went out to eat twice in 1 week.
Oh, yeah.
Great.
And I went, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I'm not answering your question accurately, because that was after 3 years getting a paycheck, right? We were in that shoebox mentality.
Yeah.
And then you went, what if we just went out again today? So you went out on Monday, and you went out again on Thursday.
Yeah.
And like, what if we went to like a
steakhouse. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Yeah. I think that was my splurge was that we went out to dinner twice in one week.
Yeah. I don't even think I noticed restaurants until I could begin to afford them. Right. Like you only know you. You're, but I didn't even know. Sometimes I looked up. I was like, when did La Scala get there? It's been there the whole time.
It's been
there
9 years.
That's been there for nine years. Yeah. I noticed the McDonald's next door. Yeah, right. I didn't even know it existed.
Yeah, believe the La Scala was next to McDonald's.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
How peculiar that seems to me.
I watch ESPN's 30 for 30 Broke every Sunday.
Ooh.
Every Sunday as just a reminder.
Just a reminder. Up to it
just as a reminder of, yeah.
Let's
just be cautious.
You know, there was a long time where I didn't realize I had money that I could spend. You know, I was still kind of living like a college kid or like a young stand-up. Yeah. And then one afternoon, I was hanging out with Louis C.K. And we had brunch together. And then he wanted me to look at something he was working on at his house. And I was like, all right, should we grab a cab? He's like, no, I can drive. And he has this like nice Porsche. And we went in the Porsche on the West Side Highway, and then we went to his apartment. He had this nice apartment. I'm like, is Louis like trying to fuck me or something? Like, I'm getting wined and dined here. This is very nice. And then I was like, why the fuck am I not doing this? I tour. I do fucking theater. Why are you doing this? What am I doing? Like, he was like, I bought this nice like record player. And I was like, I want to buy nice things. And nice. Then it like clicked in my head. I was like, I should start spending some of this money. Like, I'm touring all the time, and not spending any of it.
Right. Yeah. The great problem is when you don't have time to spend. You know, like when it's just like you're working. And
right.
So that just try and keep myself in a place where I just don't even have time to spend any money. It's just like, well, if you're just working all the time, then it's like you can't just go shopping.
Right.
Because you're at work and you know, and there's a wardrobe department, thankfully.
Yeah. All right, Rob, do you remember?
I sort of second Aziz's thing. I was doing a lot of work as a young actor and doing big leads in movies. And then one day I saw this agent who I thought was an idiot driving in front of me in this tricked out Porsche. And I'm driving my Mazda 626 that I've had, you know, for years. And I said, wait a second. If that motherfucker can have a Porsche,
right.
I'm on the cover of Tiger Beat.
I love it. Well, thank you guys so much for
doing this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
So much fun.
Thank you. Did the timer go up?
Yeah. Hey, what's up? I'm LL Cool J. Make sure you subscribe to The Hollywood Reporter. Watch some videos, baby. Peace.